Hey guys, this is Steele, and welcome to the Training Room. In this episode, we're going to focus on team protocols, what they are, how they help create consistency, and how to implement them. A protocol is the procedure that players do subconsciously. Everyone has their own protocols, and it influences their individual play, but there hasn't been much thought put into it. Protocols govern everything from good or bad spawns to countering rushes, to reacting to information, and rotations. Think about playing CT side of train. You are the player that is supposed to play close middle to lock down ladder and T connector. One round you have a good spawn, so you decide to run out middle, use an incendiary on T connector, and push towards or into the ladder room. This is your protocol for a good spawn against a gun round. Imagine you are against a T full buy, but you don't have a good spawn for a ladder. You go middle, your teammate with a better spawn will incendiary middle, and you'll use a different piece of utility, perhaps a flashbang or HE grenade. Then you'll play from the bomb train area. This is your protocol for a bad spawn. If you have a bad spawn and you're by the bomb train, after a certain amount of time, if there is no rush, you might push up and play a more aggressive position. This is part of the same protocol system. Say there was an execute happening right away though, and you were still at bomb train. You would use your incendiary at ladder or team middle based on where the smokes and flashes were coming from, or going to. I.e., are they flashing for players to come out ladder, or are they flashing to hit from team middle? These protocols at their basic levels are if-then statements. If this happens, then do that. Protocols help create consistency and success by automating reactions instead of having to think about every little detail, and it helps you understand what you should be doing and when instantly. Counter-Strike is a game that comes down to the millisecond with most decisions. Anyone you've ever known in the game will at some point say, "Ugh, timing, man." This is because there's constant windows of opportunities for players to make the biggest impact. Creating protocols that are as comprehensive as possible will eliminate a lot of these windows of opportunity and create a lot of stress on your opponents to make near-perfect decisions on the fly. Protocols also eliminate errors. How many times have you and your teammates smoked the same spot, bumped into each other, got double killed, and gone, "Man, I thought you were watching mid, and I was watching ladder." By creating multiple protocols and systems, you'll never be wondering where your teammate is, what they're watching, and who is supposed to use their utility first. Make a lot of protocols and use the ones that make the most sense for your current opponent. While creating protocols works wonders, you never want to get into the habit of being predictable. If you do the same thing every round, your opponents will be able to read this and find the best possible solution to deal with your setup. Being able to cycle through multiple protocols or to mask what you're doing are great ways to keep your opponent guessing. For example, if I am playing as a CT on DE Inferno and my team has a 3-man banana control setup and I smoke mid on it at a specific time, say around minute 45 to a minute 40, I will need to make sure that I do the exact same smoke at the exact same time on other rounds that we are not doing the 3 banana control setup. Protocols don't even have to be that complicated. Something as simple as one player creating pressure or peeking for info with another player ready to bail them out with a flashbang positioned where they can help assist against enemies without overextending is a great way to look for early picks or to delay your opponent. It can be as simple as flashing banana car from CT spawn for your teammate to go for a peek near the car and get chip damage or see if there's enemies even coming towards B, or to make your opponent scared of the possibility that you're playing by the car area so that they use flashbangs and molotovs to clear out those positions, which will in turn make their late round executions weaker as they'll be lower on utility. I think a current team that you can learn protocols from is NRG. They've recently played against Astralis at IEM Sydney, and despite their loss, they played some very disciplined and textbook style CS. In a lot of their rounds, on CT side of Overpass, they had Breeze playing near the barrels, jiggle peeking towards Monster with a smoke grenade out. His job on this round is to spot for info, and if being pressured by a B execute, he has to underhand his smoke to close to the barrels and stay alive. His teammates will play off of him and frag the enemies that are trying to find Breeze hiding in the smoke. NRG has multiple setups that are based around Breeze's barrel play, including crossfiring from the graffiti area, or playing various angles in the pit spotting for info at short B, or playing inside of short B. On this round, Breeze is doing the barrel play. If the push comes from Monster, Breeze will draw the enemy gunfire to him as his teammates crossfire from the short B sandbag area. Astralis avoids Monster and short B, but makes contact from the connector door area. After failing to get the initial pick, NRG smokes off the connector and repositions back into the bomb site in a disciplined manner. A bit later in the round, Breeze gets flash and underhands his smoke. He quickly hides in the barrel smoke and waits for his teammate to take the next contact. After Flash comes and his teammates peek, Bree switches off and takes the next contact. After showing himself briefly, he hides inside the smoke again because he knows that staying alive is more effective than going for frags. The enemy is now pressured by the barrels and is afraid that he might peek or push through the barrel smoke, so their attention is divided between Breeze and the rest of Breeze's teammates. Finally, an enemy pushes through the smoke and Breeze is able to get himself a free kill, and NRG is able to close the round out with 4 players alive. In this next example, Breeze is doing the same barrel play, but his teammates are passive with him in the pit area. The quick execute onto B happens, and Astralis is flying at a Breeze who is completely blind. After underhanding the smoke, Breeze, while still blind, hides in the smoke behind the barrels and lets his teammates take the next contact. After his teammates go 2-for-1, Breeze goes for the next contact. After shooting a few bullets, he hides, despite not actually seeing an enemy or getting a kill. Just hiding in the smoke is now delaying the enemy long enough for energy reinforcements to arrive and clean up. Energy wins the round with 4 players alive again. After running the setup regularly through the half, Astralis starts to catch on to the protocol that Energy is doing. Energy's protocol has run its course, and now it's predicted by Astralis. Astralis, knowing that Energy was never playing close monster, decides to walk 3 towards the end of monster pipe, ready to explode on the B bomb site. 2 grenades timed together come raining down on Breeze for 90 damage. Despite the grenades not killing Breeze, the damage caused and the distraction from short B drew his attention away long enough for the push to come out monster. With 2 quick frags, Astralis was able to swarm the bomb site from too many positions, and the remaining Energy players were left on an island and they were fighting at too many different angles. Astralis was able to take that round and eventually win in overtime. Don't keep your head in a box when it comes to protocols. Protocols can be as simple as calling a save in an unwinnable situation and making the best out of a bad situation. In this next example, Astralis is playing against Mousesports in the same tournament. After a string of wins, Astralis loses the B bomb site and is put into a 3-versus-3 situation. The round would be difficult to win, so Astralis made the decision to forfeit the round in a manner that would help them win future rounds. They instantly rotated to contain the enemies in the bomb site radius. Too close to the bomb and the T's would die in the explosion. If the T's pushed farther away from the bomb, they'd fall into Astralis' trap. Because Mouse was almost fully invested into the round, their economy was very delicate. Winning the round with 0 survivors puts a lot of pressure on them to succeed. Because Mouse won the previous round, losing the following round would mean that their loss bonus was reset to $1,400, and Astralis would be able to regain momentum. In short, Astralis forfeit 1 round, which heavily assisted in closing out the entire game. So, how can your team implement protocols? Usually you'll figure out the best protocols through experience or trial and error. The more reps you get in the game, the more chance your opponents will have to exploit your weaknesses. When you lose when doing your protocols, use that as a learning experience in several ways. You can patch the holes in your protocols so that you can account for what your opponent was doing to you. And if you play against a team that does similar protocols on their CT side, you'll know what an effective counter to it is by mimicking what your opponent did to you. Watch other teams play and learn from them. You don't need to clone their setups entirely, but you can take cool, innovative, or efficient parts of other teams' setups and protocols and apply it to your own team. I hope you learned a lot from this episode of the Predator Training Room, and I hope to see you next time.